and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us confess our sin to God, who is faithful and just, and who has promised to forgive our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, have mercy on us. We confess to you that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not trusted you with our whole heart. We have not loved one another in deed and in truth. In your compassion, forgive our sin, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our light and truth. Amen. With joy, I proclaim to you that Almighty God, rich in mercy, abundant in love, forgives you all your sin and grants you newness of life in Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Eternal Lord, your kingdom
is growing into our whole world through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son. Help us to hear your word and obey it, so that we may become instruments of your redeeming love, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to worship. Please indicate your presence here today by using the QR code that you'll see on the back of the bulletin or in the pew rack in front of you, or if you're in the front row at the sides there, you'll see a card that says, "We're glad you're here." Please fill that out and put it in one of the offering baskets on either end of the pew. Welcome once again to God's house. Following the second service today, there'll be some lunches that are being made for our Union Gospel Mission Ministry. If you can assist with that, that would be greatly appreciated. That's following the second service today. Lent services midweek are at 6:30, with the exception of this coming Wednesday. There's no Lenten service this coming Wednesday. That'll resume a week from this coming Wednesday, and we commend those additional opportunities for worship for you. A Wisconsin fish fry is being planned for March 31st. That's a Friday evening, 6 p.m. All are welcome. That'll be here at the church in the Family Life Center on the 31st at 6 p.m. Please keep in your prayers today 10 of our middle school and high school youth that are with our Director of Ministries, David Colson. They are in Tulsa today. They're worshiping there, and they are also ministering in a women's shelter and in association with a children's ministry. So please keep them in your prayers as they minister over spring break. We continue now with the anthem for the morning.
Merciful God, abounding in love, faithful to all who draw near you. A reading from the book of Romans. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. So also David speaks of the blessedness of those whom God reckons righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one against whom the Lord will not reckon sin. Here ends the reading. We will now speak from the psalm responsively. I will lift up my heart to the hills. For where will my help come from? And who will not let your foot be moved? He who keeps Israel.
According to St. Luke, the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then he, being Jesus, took the 12 aside and said to them, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. For he will be handed over to the Gentiles, and he will be mocked and insulted and spat upon. After they have flogged him, they will kill him, and on the third day he will rise again." But they understood nothing about all these things. In fact, what he said was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what was said. The Gospel of the Christ. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Open your Bibles, please, with me to the 18th chapter of the Gospel of Luke for our study this morning. Luke, the 18th chapter. If you're using a pew edition of Holy Scripture, you're going to find that on page 71. Luke, the 18th chapter. We stand at the cusp, really, of entering into such a rich, rich week in the life of the church, that being Holy Week. Just a few weeks away now. We'll enter once again as a family of God. We'll enter in and follow in the footsteps of our Lord. There'll be the shout of Hosanna on Palm Passion Sunday, but also the remembrance of the reason why Jesus had gone and would be going into Jerusalem to redeem the world, to die and to rise. There'll be the depth and the quiet of Maundy Thursday, the washing of the disciples' feet, Jesus instituting the sacrament of Holy Communion at a Passover celebration. On Good Friday, we'll enter into the somberness of that day. The adult choir preparing a beautiful, beautiful and meaningful cantata that evening. There'll be the stripping of the altar, the entrance into the blackness of Friday. And a congregation respectfully understanding the solemn nature, leaving in quiet and silence into the darkness of the night. And then into the crown of Sundays, Easter Sunday. Holy Week is a magnificent week of worship and gathering of God's people. But in these days, prior to Holy Week, we're examining a sermon series entitled Just Before. And we're examining what was it that Jesus was doing? What was it that he was saying just before Holy Week? What was he doing? What was he saying in the holy days before Holy Week? And so as we anticipate Holy Week, we also enter into the holy days before Holy Week. And we turn to Luke, the 18th chapter, and we see and we hear one of the things that Jesus was doing just before Holy Week. Look with me, please, at verse 31 of Luke, the 18th chapter. Then he took the 12 aside and said to them, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished." This is one of the what's called passion predictions of our Lord. And notice that our Lord says, everything that is written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. He's rooting what is occurring and what will occur in the scriptures that have been given. You remember a few years ago where we had the series Retro? It was a year-long series, and we never ever left the Old Testament, did we? We preached Christmas Eve from the Old Testament. We did Easter from the whole Old Testament. Holy Week from the Old Testament. Every time we gathered on the Lord's Day, the text was from the Old Testament. And we could see how the Old Testament points forward to the Lord Jesus Christ. We can see the unfolding of the ministry of Christ that would come at the time. We could see it all unfolded in the Old Testament as there was a pointing forward, the prophecy of exactly what the Messiah would do. Jesus, in the holy days before Holy Week, he turns to the disciples, he gives the passion prediction, and he roots what has occurred and what is occurring in the Word. In the Word. It's interesting to note that really when you look at the ministry of Jesus, you can divide it into two different sections when you look at the Gospels. You have his ministry in Galilee, and then you have what's called the journey narrative. That's where the face is set, and he then moves to Jerusalem. There's really two different circles that you can draw in the Gospels. Is this the Galilean ministry, or is this the narrative here where he is moving toward the cross? At this point, Jesus has just crossed the Jordan River, the approach to Jericho, and then the ascent, the steep ascent to Jerusalem. He goes on, verse 32. For he will be handed over to the Gentiles, and he will be mocked and insulted and spat upon. After they've flogged him, they will kill him. And on the third day, he will rise again. This is the fourth time since Luke 9 that Jesus has told his disciples he's going to suffer. The fourth time he said it. Certainly, he has in mind the prophecy in Isaiah 53, the prophecy of the Messiah, written in what's called the historical present. In other words, it's written as if something that is going to be has already occurred. That communicates there's such confidence that this is going to happen. It's communicated as if it already is, has happened. Isaiah 53, about the Messiah. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. So in one of the holy days before Holy Week, Jesus is teaching the disciples, and he gives the passion prediction. He roots it in the prophetic word of Holy Scripture. What has happened? What will happen? The cross then into Jordan, the approach to Jerusalem, the ascent up into Jerusalem. And the reaction to what he said? Look at verse 34. But they understood nothing about all these things. In fact, what he said was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what was said. Notice the threefold emphasis here in this verse on the inability of the disciples to get it. They understood nothing. It was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what was said. The concept of a Messiah that would be killed was antithetical to the expectation of the Jews. As one author puts it, they were expecting a coronation, not a crucifixion. They were expecting a Messiah that would kill people, not be killed. Their anticipation was for the overthrow of the Roman government. And yet Jesus says he's going to be killed. Paul says, 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, but we proclaim Christ crucified. Now catch this. A stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. It was a stumbling block to the Jews. Why? It wasn't what they were anticipating. It wasn't what they were longing for. A Messiah that would turn to them and say, I'm going to be killed. I'm going to be killed. Antithetical to their expectation. But they understood nothing about all these things. In fact, what he said was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what was said. Well, of course, right? With an expectation like that, they're not going to get it. With an expectation like that, they're not going to grasp what was being said. But notice that little phrase there. Notice that little phrase, in fact, what he said was hidden from them. It was hidden from them. Look closer there. Gospel of Luke, 9th chapter. Jesus says, let these words sink into your ears. In other words, remember them. Let these words sink into your ears. The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into human hands. Okay, here's this passion prediction again, right? And then the scripture says, but they did not understand this saying. Its meaning was concealed from them, so they could not perceive it. It was concealed from them, so they couldn't perceive it. Well, that sounds an awful lot like the text, doesn't it? Verse 34. They understood nothing about all these things. In fact, what he said was hidden from them. In Luke 9, in Luke 18, this is an example of what's called a theological passive when you look at the language. A theological passive. What does that mean? It means that the disciples not only didn't understand what Jesus was saying, the disciples couldn't understand what Jesus was saying. And why? Because they were being kept from understanding. Okay, then. What was keeping them from understanding, right? It's not a what. It's a who. So who was keeping the disciples from understanding? Are you ready? God. God. They didn't comprehend it. They didn't grasp it. They didn't understand it. And why? Because God was keeping them from understanding it. Okay. And why would God do that? Why would God keep the disciples from understanding the passion prediction? He's going to go to the cross. They're going to mock, scourge, and crucify him. He's going to be killed, and on the third day he was going to rise again. Why did Jesus keep them from understanding? Turn with me, please, to Matthew 16. That's on page 16 if you're in a pew edition. Matthew chapter 16, verse 16. Excuse me, verse 21. Matthew 16, we'll pick up in verse 21. Here we have it again. Here we have one of those passion predictions, right? From that time on, verse 21, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. There it is again. It is one of those passion predictions, right? Can't get clearer than that. What was Peter's reaction to this? Verse 22, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you. Now, do you see that in your mind's eye? Peter taking the second member of the Trinity aside and rebuking him and telling him, this must not happen. And what's Jesus' response? But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me. Notice what he calls him, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Jesus predicts what indeed will happen. He gives the passion prediction, and Peter says, oh no, that must not happen. Okay, back to the text now. In the text, God hides for a purpose. He hides the understanding for a purpose. And what's the purpose of his hiding the understanding? What would the disciples do if they understood that Jesus was going to be killed? It's Peter's reaction, isn't it? If they understand what indeed is going to happen at this point, what are the disciples going to do? God forbid it. And what might they do? Literally, physically, keep him from that occurring. They are kept from understanding at this point, and it was only after the cross and after the resurrection that we see God opening their eyes so that they would understand the actions of Jesus Christ. It was only after the cross and after the resurrection. Why? Because the Lord Jesus Christ is determined to go to the cross. Determined. This was a plan, Ephesians 1, that God had in place before he ever said, let there be anything. There was the plan of salvation already in place. Because God in his omniscience knew of the fall of humankind that would to come. This was the plan that was already in place. And Jesus would let nothing thwart that plan. Absolutely nothing. And God conceals, hides the understanding of the passion prediction because nothing will thwart the plan of a determined God. In the holy days before Holy Week, we read they understood nothing about all these things. In fact, what he said was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what was said, and determined, the Lord Jesus Christ goes to the cross, and the plan is expressed. And Jesus, the spotless Lamb of God, takes your sin and my sin, the sin of the world, the sin of everyone who ever was at the time or would be. He bore it all on the cross the justice of God falling on the spotless Lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ, who sheds his blood and takes the wrath of God for sin upon himself, so that through the blood of Christ we are reconciled unto God. He is then raised on the third day. Death is overcome, the verification that the sacrifice has been accepted. The determined God who lives out the plan, and nothing would thwart it. By nature, we don't have an understanding of the Lord Jesus Christ. We don't have a love for the Lord Jesus Christ by nature. We don't have an understanding of who he is and what he's done. There is by nature absolutely no faith in us. In fact, the Bible tells us we want nothing to do with God. By nature, it is all hidden from us. It must be revealed to us. You see, the fact that is hidden from us, that's not some theological passive here. Not for us. God is not keeping us from understanding. No, we are by nature a people that don't understand. We don't get Jesus. In fact, we don't even want to get Jesus by nature. And that's because of the reality and condition of our sinfulness. But the determined God comes to us, and he claims us in the waters of baptism, and he says, "You're mine, I'm not letting you go." He washes us in the promises of the cross and the empty tomb. He feeds us his very body and blood as we come and receive it at the altar. He comes to us in word and in sacrament, birthing and sustaining and growing our faith. That's a determined God. And the hidden is revealed. And understanding and faith is born. Because God is determined. Let us rise, confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, and he descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Please remain standing.
pray for the people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord of grace, you have brought us to your house, calling us to worship you in spirit and truth. Receive our praise and hear our prayers, that we would leave this place satisfied with your living water, strengthened for the mission before us this week. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, we praise you for your words and actions during the holy days before Holy Week. We praise you, Lord Jesus, for your determination to redeem us. Lord, in your mercy. Father Almighty, we know the promised quote from Psalms is for us as your redeemed people. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us through your Son. Lord, in your mercy. God of comfort and peace, we lift before your throne Barbara Walker, Richard Knowles, the Dabb family, Crystal Shue, Linda Creech, the Brooke family, Joanne Bailey, Romeo Fernandez, Joey Knudsen, and Donna Jensen. Hear now, O Lord, the prayers we hold on our lips and in our hearts. Into your hands, Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your goodness and mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, our Lord took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You are all invited to this table of grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gifts of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. And we pray that in your mercy, you would strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
May the Lord make his face to shine on you and to be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you of his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Now go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.